Hey everyone, hopefully you can see and hear me okay. If someone is out there, please drop a hello or an emoji or something in there so that I know I'm not on my own talking to myself. That would be amazing. If you're new around here, oh good, I am online. Thank you, Lauren. If you're new around here, hi, I'm Vicky, founder of The Fashion Business Coach, and every month I invite a guest on to chat with me live about a topic relating to fashion, sustainability, entrepreneurship, so that you can get inspired and pick up some tips as well, just to help your brand move forward. Shortly today, I'm going to be joined by Natalia, who is a copywriting and branding expert, and she's going to teach us about copywriting, what that means, and storytelling as well, and just why it's so powerful for making sales in your business. We are nearing the holiday season, the busiest time of year, and it is a time when we want to be focusing on our marketing, so I'm really hoping that today's live is going to help with that. While we wait for Natalia, I'd love for you to say hello, let us know where you're joining from, and I'm curious to know, does anyone actually know what copywriting is? Is it something you've heard of before? Is it something that you're working on, or is it totally brand new, clueless? But that's okay too, we can learn all about it today. Hi Natalia, whenever you're ready, you can press to join me live and I will invite you and we can both be there. There you are. Hopefully I'll be able to see you in a second.
Hi.
There you are. Hello. How are you?
I'm very good. How are you?
Good. Thank you. We've got a few people joining us. I don't know if you heard, I just gave a very brief introduction, but I was actually going to tell everyone how we know each other because we both have that or a mutual interest in sustainability. So that's how we first met. And then I got to learn about your copywriting and branding, and I'm excited for us to be working together as well. And for anybody who doesn't know, the brand or the company that Natalia set up is called Green Studio MX, which I'll be linking in here. And yeah, you're just the go-to branding and copywriting expert, aren't you? I'd love to know a little bit more about what you do, and for anybody who hasn't heard of you before.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I'm really excited to talk to you because
thank you.
I think that in this space, it's also a lot about collaboration and, you know, starting to get relationships and build relationships, and you never know what that leads to. So that's basically how I started Green Studio. I started Green Studio because first I started a fashion blog, a sustainable fashion blog, because at the moment I was living in the US, and since I couldn't like legally work there because my husband had the work visa, I was like figuring out what should I do. I want to do something for me. I don't want to stay at home and not work. And then I said, I'll just do what I like to do. I'll start to write, I'll start to work with brands because I've always loved fashion. So I thought about, you know, starting this and doing it in a formal way. And then eventually, some of the brands that I started working with were, since I studied marketing and I always wanted to give them like a good complete package when they worked with me, I started to give marketing advice to them. And then that's sort of how it snowballed into what I do now, because it was like, yeah, I'm helping these sustainable brands, you know, have a better marketing strategy. So why shouldn't, you know, I do this for like as a job? So that's how I first had a blog, but then I changed the name and I migrated everything to Green Studio to just, you know, make it more make sense and to offer this to sustainable brands. So that's basically how it all started.
I love that. And I love that, you know, it grew organically into, you know, it started as a hobby. And I think a lot of people watching this, it's probably in a similar situation. You know, they had a hobby, they love fashion, wanted to get into it somehow. And now I'm kind of exploring the opportunity to have their own brand, or maybe already have their own brand. There's a little bit of a mix in here today, which is amazing. And I think you do have to do that. You have to follow your passion, but also follow kind of what makes sense. And I know when I started this business, I never thought I'd have like an online course, for example, but I've had it for years now and I love it. And whatever business you're in, I think you have to listen to people and kind of adjust course sometimes. And it's exciting to see where the business takes you.
Yeah. And actually, like when I was reading also like about your journey that you, I think you started a fashion brand first, and then that also made you snowball into what you do. It's sort of something like that happened to me as well before the blog, because I also had like on the side a brand with my mom when we both used to live in Mexico and stuff. Yeah, but then obviously when you start a business, you have no idea what you're doing. And then when before the blog, I was like, I want to sell clothes. And then I was like, my website's not getting traffic. And then I was like, I should start a blog. And then when I did the blog, I loved the writing part more. And since like it was too complicated to make my business work in the US because of the legal requirements. So I said, I'm just gonna do the blog, right? But still, like you mentioned, following your passion always opens doors, because I never thought that I would be doing this and, you know, working with brands that I love and doing what I love. It wasn't something that I had in my mind. Like, yeah, when I'm, you know, 27, I'm going to have this type of business. It just snowballed, because when you do what you like, you know, opportunities start coming in. So
definitely. And it's amazing, actually, the number of startup brands that I've worked with who started out as like lawyers or in finance. One of the current projects I'm on, actually, she's in finance. And yeah, you know, they did it because they thought, oh, it's a safe job. Like, it's what my parents want me to do, something like that. And then they just thought, you know what, like, life's too short. I'm going to follow my passion. And, you know, you just have so much more motivation. It's just so much easier to succeed, I think, when you're doing something you love.
Yeah. Yeah.
So now we know that you love copywriting, and it's handy that you're so good at it as well. I suspect there's a few people watching who haven't got a clue what copywriting means, maybe don't know why it's important. So how would you explain that? And also storytelling as well, because I guess the two kind of go hand in hand, really, don't they?
Yeah, definitely. Like, they go hand in hand, but they are very different. And like, for me, copywriting is the part about, you know, creating content so that users take actions. So it's really anything that you can write, literally, like on your website, your social media captions, your newsletters, whatever type of content that you can write, that's copywriting. And because you're writing that piece of content with the purpose of making people take actions. But then when you combine it with storytelling is when it gets more powerful, because storytelling is telling your story and it's making it more engaging. And it's more of like the artistic part of copywriting. I like to look at it that way, because it's when you put in your brand tone and the brand messaging that you want to have out there to make sure that the people that are reading, you know, your content get more hooked, and not everybody is really developing the storytelling part of their businesses. And it's so powerful. And that's why I ended up doing what I'm doing, because, you know, combining copywriting with storytelling really helps you sell without being salesy all the time. And, you know, it makes you create a community, you know, share content that shows that you care about sharing things and, you know, educating people or helping someone in their purchase decision without telling them right now it's a 24-hour sale. If you don't buy, you're gonna die, you know. It's really more about making,
it feels like that sometimes, people, isn't it?
Yeah, but it's more about like making people want to become part of, you know, the values that you promote as a brand. And that's where the combination works. So that's how I would explain it, I guess.
No, I love that. And I would add as well, I think when people, like so many people say to me, oh, I want to start, say, a swimwear brand, but it's so competitive, like I'm never going to make it. There's too many competitors. But actually, it's the storytelling largely and the marketing that is going to set you apart, because as a small brand, you know, you have such power in the way that you do storytelling and copywriting versus a big generic brand that, sure, everybody knows their name and they've got a big budget, but they can't really build that deep connection because everyone knows it's an email that's probably gone out to like a million people. Whereas if you can craft something really personal in your storytelling and tell the story of your brand and your products, like, it's so much more powerful.
Yeah, definitely. And it also helps you like build more trust with your audience, because I see like this mistake happen a lot, especially with fashion brands, that, you know, they all have the check marks on their to-do list, like they have the Shopify website, you know, they have the products, they have the newsletter opt-in, but then there's like not much more on their website, right? So it's it's also important to have like more content on your website to sort of back up a little bit about the values that you want to promote. So, you know, if you are a sustainable brand, you should definitely have a page talking about your work ethics, your sustainability, your artisans, all of that, because that really helps when someone is landing on your website, they know that there's more to it, you know, that they know that instead of buying on Amazon, they're supporting a brand that has a story to tell, but they have a story because they care and they're sharing about it. But most brands don't really share about that. I don't know why, because maybe they don't have time or they don't think it's important, but I do think that it definitely helps to really make marketing a little bit more meaningful.
Yeah. And I think it makes it a lot more fun as well. Like if you're just trying to post like promotion after promotion, it gets, as a business owner, I find it gets really boring. Whereas if you're kind of telling the story and thinking about why you're telling that story, whether it's to inspire people into being more sustainable, or if it is something sales driven, but saying it in a non-slimy, non-sleazy way, it can just make selling so much easier and so much nicer as well, without feeling like you're asking for the sale all the time.
Exactly. Yeah, definitely. And like, for example, if some of your brand values are, I don't know, like mindfulness or something like that, if you sell something that's like, I don't know, yoga pants, probably meditation and mindfulness is something very important, you know, for the essence of your brand. So also creating content around that, you know, maybe doing meditation groups, or, you know, letting people come to live events or stuff like that. That also helps, because you have to sort of attract the type of people that you want to your business. And like we are mentioning, right? When you do something, like take those little extra steps because you truly care about building that community, it shows. It's going to show in your content, and it's going to show that you're not just, you know, waiting for the sales to come in. You're also waiting to build that community and to have people interested in the essence of your brand.
And it just becomes so much bigger than just clothing. Like, it becomes a community, a movement, and so many amazing things can happen when people come together for a common kind of cause, especially in the sustainability space. One thing I did want to mention is something that I've noticed as being a real area where business owners kind of let themselves down is on the product descriptions. And copywriting and storytelling can go into product descriptions. I think people think in the product description, it has to be like, this is a dress, it is made of 100% cotton, and be really factual about it. And yes, it is important to, you know, to tell people what it is so they know what to expect. You can still put storytelling in places like your product descriptions, can't you?
Yeah, definitely. Like actually, one of my clients that I love, that you can go check them out, Sentinel. She does a lot of that, like, on her website too, because I understand that, especially as a sustainable brand, it's a big struggle to say, you know, to claim what you want to claim about sustainability, because it's like, you don't want to say too much so that people don't get mad if you use a little bit of plastic, but okay, maybe if you're using plastic, you're giving back in some sort, in some other way, or you're promoting recycling or anything like that. So I wouldn't stress too much about having that perfect, like, product description that you're mentioning. And you can definitely add some little bits of creative writing into your storytelling. So this brand that I was mentioning, like, she calls her brand like the vanilla cake icing. No, sorry, like vanilla icing on the cake of life or something like that. So that's like something fun, something like, oh, this is fun, I want to buy this accessory. Oh, I know that she gives back to 1% for the planet, but she also has like really creative phrases that, you know, that communicated emotion to the reader, and that's what you really want. People buy more with their emotions, really, and we make emotional 100%. Decisions. So that's where really the copywriting and storytelling comes in, because it's not just about giving you the facts. Yes, we donate, you know, 100% of our profits to blah blah blah. Yes, our products are 79% organic. Yes, that's very important, and we love to read that as conscious consumers, but we also love to become hooked by that emotional part. And when you learn to tie that in, that's very powerful, because sometimes a really emotional phrase like this, you know, with your purchase, you are helping the artisans and blah, blah, blah. That also helps as well, right? Because you know that, okay, maybe this product is not 100% sustainably perfect, but I know that my purchase is having an impact because they're telling me that in their storytelling. So that's sort of where you want to combine it.
I love that you brought that up, because it isn't possible right now to have that 100% sustainable product. So the fact that you're, you know, being transparent about what is and isn't, and just making sure that people understand, like, we're not perfect yet, but we want to work on this so that we can be. I think it's really good to communicate to people, and especially for just making people more aware of sustainability as well. I think if you are a sustainable brand, it's important to do that and do that kind of education piece as well.
Yeah, definitely.
So for anybody who's watching this and who we've kind of convinced, maybe they didn't know about this before and they're thinking, okay, I want to get involved. Like, how can I introduce stories, or, you know, how can I improve my copywriting? Where's like one place that they could start, or what's one big tip that you could give so that they can, you know, go away from this and actually do something?
Yeah, like, definitely I would say start a blog.
Okay, because, I love it.
Yeah. A blog will open so many doors for you, and I'm the type of person that loves systems in a business, so
Me
I'm
too.
not really the type of person that will spend, you know, 10 hours on Instagram creating content, because I like to create systems where I can repurpose the content. So when you get strategic with doing that, having a blog, everything and your marketing even gets easier, because you when you invest your time, money, and energy in, you know, writing for your blog, because you can do it by yourself, or you can hire someone to write that for you, because it is time consuming. You're like crossing more, you're taking more like marks on a big marketing strategy, because you're going to be creating content where people that are searching for content on Google for buying, they're going to be finding you, right? So if they don't follow you on social media, if they weren't active on Instagram that day and they didn't see your ad or your post, when they're looking for sustainable options or how to style a hat or how to wear a scarf or, you know, tutorial kind of content, your content starts to appear on Google, and then you have an opportunity with every single blog post to create a marketing funnel, because this way, when people are landing there, they're going to be reading, you know, that educational piece of content, and you can have different types of blog posts. They don't all have to be educational. You can also create, for example, for this type of season, you can create gift guides, right? So like the sustainable gift guide from ethical brands, and you can collaborate with other brands, include them in your blog post, and then you can start to mix up, you know, your marketing strategy of writing gift guides for seasonal you know, seasonal times, sorry, and also educational content. And then you can make sure that each type of content has opt-ins in your blog, so that then you can start to build your email list. So then you start to see that having a blog is part of your system, because it's not just I'm writing content and I have to wait, you know, 1 year for it to get traffic from Google, because there's also the SEO part of content marketing, where when you write content for a blog, yes, it's not going to be like you're going to get results overnight, but you're like building this really robust online presence with your website, where you're making sure that like every single type of content that you've put on Instagram, it's on your blog as well. So it's not like content wasted. It's there for people when they're searching for it. And you can always find ways to repurpose that and to turn your blog posts into Instagram captions, into your newsletters. When you're out of ideas of, I don't know what to send out this week, you can probably, you know, scroll on your blog database. Oh, I'm going to send out, you know, this tip for meditation, or this tip on how to use scents for, I don't know, you know, like you can have a lot of ideas. And then you start to see that, you know, having it is really, it's really giving you more than what you invest in really, you know, having it. So it's, I think that's like the main tip that I would give, that it's really important to have a blog.
I'm so happy that you brought that up, because that's something that I've been saying for a while and teaching, but people are like, writing a blog, like, but those examples you've given, like, they're so easy that even if you're not a writer, like, you can pull together a gift guide, like, anybody can do that. And it's not something that has to take like hours and hours. You're not going to have to go and do loads of research and credit all these sources and all this stuff, you know. It's something that anybody can do, and for most people who are watching this and are interested in fashion, you probably got some ideas anyway as to what would go on something like a gift guide. So it's definitely great content to pull together. And the other thing I love about having a blog is you're absolutely right, like, it does bring people in from Google, whereas if you're trying to get, you know, a top ranking on Google for, say, sustainable swimwear, that keyword, that phrase is going to be so competitive, like, it's super difficult to get to the top. But if you're providing something else, like on the blog, content that's really helpful, it can kind of be like a back way for people to find you almost. And certainly with my fashion brand, I always found that, for instance, one of the brands I had, the first one, was an occasion wear business. And, you know, I knew I was never going to rank high for something like wedding guest dress or something like that. But I'd have blog posts on things like how to get the perfect wedding gift or something like that. And that would bring so much traffic to my business. And even though I no longer run that business, 10 years later, it still gets traffic, because once it's there, it's there. It's not like an Instagram post where it's going to age and after kind of 24 to 48 hours, it's dead and no one's going to find it. It lives there forever.
Yeah, I was definitely going to talk about this last point that you were mentioning, because I'm not against Instagram, honestly. Like, I like the platform, but I like to be really strategic with how I spend my time marketing my business. Yeah. And that's like the main tip that I have for whoever's watching this, because yes, having a blog, and when you, especially if you don't like to write, it might sound like I don't have time for that. But when you look at it in a different way, like, okay, maybe writing 12 blog posts a year, like one per month, you can definitely give yourself the space 2 to 3 hours per month to write one blog post. And then if those blog posts can be repurposed into 12 newsletters, into 12 or 24 Instagram captions, then you have 2 months of content already done for you in your plan. So then you only have to think about what I'm going to write the next 8 months. So it starts to become part of a system that's sustainable, that doesn't drain your energy, and that you know that that when you're using your creative energy to write content, you're making sure that you're putting it in different channels so other people can also make use of that content, and so that it doesn't get lost in the algorithms. And also when you're having a blog, and you have it for a while and it starts to grow, and over time you start to get traffic, it's also it can also become a reliable source of traffic for your business, where probably when you're starting out, you think that the only way to get customers is with Facebook ads and with Google ads and with, you know, working with influencers, working with the ones who already have that audience. And you can definitely build that. Like I mentioned, before I started my business, I had this sustainable fashion blog, and I was getting around 80,000 yearly visits for free just by promoting my blog, using Pinterest, you know, putting the work to write. And right now I'm building my traffic again. I'm not there. I'm not on the same visits as I was before, because my type of content is different. And that's where you can start to see also like the return, right? Where you're spending your time on marketing strategies that may seem like they're not going to work, but they're really helping you have a stronger online presence that doesn't get lost with algorithms, and that will allow you to not depend on spending money on advertising all the time.
Yeah. And as we've seen, anybody who is doing paid ads, which admittedly is not me, I actually follow the same strategy as you. So I don't typically spend money on ads. I just rely on the blog and free methods. But people who are paying for ads are seeing that their costs are just skyrocketing. And, you know, as a small business, that becomes a lot to absorb. And if you've relied solely on that, it means that, you know, a lot of people can't afford to do business that way anymore and are losing the sales. So if you can adopt this kind of strategy, it's good for so many reasons. But one of them that I love is if you have got that kind of central piece of content, that blog post, you can easily distribute that out onto whatever channels that you want. And chances are most people aren't going to be following you on every channel. Like, I'll be very surprised if anyone watching this follows me here, is on my email list, on YouTube, on Pinterest, like on Facebook. Like, I'll be very surprised. So you can repurpose it without boring people, because most of them are only going to see it on the one channel. It's not like they'll see the same thing 5 times.
Exactly. Yeah. And like, maybe another tip that I have, like in terms of growing your email list also with the copywriting is and storytelling, is that I mentioned that when you have a blog, you can have every blog post is an opportunity to get people inside your marketing funnels. So you can have different types of funnels, and most e-commerce brands only have the 10% off discount, subscribe, and then you get an email sequence, and then you're just pushing people to buy. But there's also other type of opt-ins that you can create that I've also seen other brands do. For example, I don't know if you've heard of Veda Capsule.
Yes, I have, yeah.
That they sell like this capsule wardrobe type of thing.
Yeah, I love that concept.
Their blog, they have an opt-in that's like, download the guide to how to create, you know, learn how to create a capsule wardrobe. So you know, you have the opt-in with the bribe for the discount, but you also have the opt-in for the people that, you know, love the niche and they want to learn how to create a capsule wardrobe. And then you can have another funnel for that. And then if you want to speed things up and don't want to rely strictly on waiting until Google, you know, picks up your post, because there's a little bit of a science to SEO as well. Like, you can't just write, I'm going to write about wedding gifts and everyone's going to find you. You have to find what keywords you have a chance of really ranking for. Once you, like, if you want to cut that time frame, you can also list builds directly, you know, sending paid advertising to your opt-ins. But when there are opt-ins that provide value, it's more likely that people will subscribe. So for example, for my business right now, I have like an ongoing opt-in that you don't have to change it up all the time, but it's the content planner, right? Like it's my content planner that helps you, you know, learn a little bit about how to create these systems, organize your categories, blah, blah, blah. But it's like an evergreen opt-in that anyone who wants to have an online business can download. So I consistently send ads to that opt-in, and then people are part of my email list. And then you can have, you know, different kinds of funnels for, okay, you downloaded this opt-in, and then I'm going to introduce my brand. I'm going to tell you about my amazing values, the things that I'm doing to save the planet, and blah, blah, blah. And then you give them, you know, the offers to start to buy from you. So that's like another way to sort of cut the time frame a little bit, but it's all about mixing the strategies that work for you and your budget.
Yeah, definitely. I think budget plays such a big part in it. But and I was just going to pick up on that point about the email sequence when someone subscribes to you. Another lost opportunity I see so many brands have, that they'll get people to sign up for their email list and then they just don't do anything with it. But that's like prime time to use that storytelling method that you were teaching us, so that we can tell people, like, this is our brand, why should they care? Rather than just trying to pitch our offer straight away, if we can just do that bit of introduction and tell people really who we're for, who we're there to support and help, and who our products are for, it can go a long way into building that trust with the customer so they feel confident in making the purchase.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, that's super important, because like another example of a brand that that I like their storytelling, but it's not a brand that I currently follow. But at the beginning when I discovered Everlane, I don't know if you've heard of that brand as well, but yeah, like they were sort of the pioneers in this niche, right? So when I checked their website out, I subscribed to their newsletter, and immediately I started getting these emails like, oh, you know, there's an email about my factory, here's an email about, you know, the raw materials and how much our cotton tea costs. So that was like really game changing at the moment, because they were the first that were doing it. So I was like really hooked, and I was like, maybe I'm not ready to at this moment buy from you, because whatever reason, maybe I don't have the budget right now, but you got me hooked. And then the next time I'm thinking about shopping, especially if I'm a conscious consumer, you're going to be in the top of my mind. Because, you know, you had something different to say. But that's very important what you were mentioning. Like, if you have an email list and you don't nurture it, you're probably losing potential money that you have there already, because it's people that you can start to nurture and tell your story and make them repeat customers.
Yeah, and that's such a good point as well. Not everyone's going to be ready to buy today. You know, they might not have the cash today. It might be that, you know, they really like your, or in the case of my previous business, a lot of people would be like, oh, I really like your stuff, but I don't have a wedding or event to go to right now. Like, so you've got to nurture that relationship so that when they do think, oh, I've been invited to a wedding, you need your name to be the first one that pops into their head, or insert appropriate idea for your business, whatever's relevant. If you're swimwear, oh, my vacation's booked, I need some new swimwear. You know, you are the top of mind when people are ready to make that purchase.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, so many good tips there. If anybody watching's got any questions to ask either of us, feel free to pop that in the comments box. I know we've covered a lot, so if you need any clarification, let us know. In the meantime, you've touched on it briefly already, but you do have a download that we're going to link to as well. Do you want to just tell us a little bit more about it? And I'll pop the link in the replay when that's up in a little while.
Basically, if you want an example of content writing and copywriting and blog, a strategic blog, you can stalk my website and you can see everything that I've talked about on this live. But yeah, like my main resource is the content planner. But I also have on my menu a resource tab where I'm linking to like my best blog post. And that's also like a best practice, because it helps to have like your best content out there on your menu for people who are ready to buy your product or your service. So in my case, I have like my best resources on my menu, so that you know my best tips to grow your newsletter, to grow your email. To grow your email list, to have a strategic website flow, etc. So like you can check out all of those resources in my menu too.
Okay, fantastic. Well, I'll definitely link to that and also tag you as well. So if you're not following along already, you can follow Green Studio and see the updates. And if anybody's interested in working with you, what kind of help can you give them and what kind of services do you offer?
Yeah, so basically I do blog copywriting. Yep. If you haven't noticed that, I'm obsessed with blogs. But I'm obsessed with them because, like I mentioned, they help you create systems for your business. So I have different types of working together because I know that, the budget, it might not be the same for every brand. So I have like a way in which I can help you create like the content plan for your business, and I can give you like the templates of this is a format of how you should write a blog post to rank on Google. These are the 12 topics that you can write about for the next year. And you can sort of produce that yourself, but it's like a package where you start doing that. Or you can also hire me for the monthly copywriting, where we basically do the same, but the difference is that I produce the content for you with my team. And I also, make some services for email writing a little bit a la carte, like whatever the client needs. Like I'm going to start with you.
I'm excited for that.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, that's amazing. So I'm going to link to all of that. I think we've answered everybody's questions. So I think we can wrap it up there. But I'm so grateful that you joined us. You've given us so much to think about, so many amazing tips. Mm-hmm. So thank you so much.
No, thank you so much for having me. It was really fun to talk about.
You're so welcome. For the people that are just joining now and are late, I'm going to post the replay as soon as the video processes on Instagram. So that'll all be available to watch again if anyone wants to. We did run through a lot, so you might need a recap. So it's going to be on there, on both of our channels, actually, isn't it? If anyone wants to take a look.
Perfect.
Alrighty. Thank you so much, guys. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.